So welcome to the second talk of this session by Martin Höf from MapScientia, GC2 Vidi, what's new on the spatial data infrastructure project. He will show us today, and if you want to introduce a little bit more yourself, yeah, feel free.
Yes, good afternoon to all of you. I'm Martin Høgh, and I have a small company called MapScientia, located in Denmark, and we are developing open source software, which I will tell you about in 1 minute. So, what is GC2 Vidi? It's actually two projects, GC2 and Vidi, but because they're closely linked, they appear as one project in OSGeo context. You can use GC2 without Vidi, but you can't use, because it's the back end, but you can't use Vidi without GC2 because it's the front end. This is the OSGeo webpage for GC2 Vidi. It became a OSGeo community project last year, about 10 months ago. And from this page, there are links to the GitHub repositories, demos, and much more. So this is what the GC2 Vidi page states. The GC2 Vidi framework helps you build a spatial infrastructure quickly and easily, powered by using open source components for scalable solution focused on freedom rather than fees. And it comprises two software projects. GC2 makes it easy to deploy PostGIS, MapServer, QGIS Server, MapCache, Elasticsearch, and so on, and offer an easy-to-use browser application to configure the whole software stack. And Vidi is a modern take on browser GIS. It's the front-end client for GC2. So before I get started on the review, I will just list some users so you can get an idea about what kind of software it is. So Danish municipalities at both local and regional level is the primary user segment. And Danish municipalities are a rather big organization with a lot of responsibilities comprising land and zoning, processing on building application, handling of contaminated areas, nature conservation, and so on, infrastructure. There's some engineering companies, big ones, using it, like Kavi and Aragon in South Africa. There's public utility and transport companies. They use it for planning and management of pipe, wells, routes, etc. Also, museums, shipping, national parks, and so on are using it. So you can say it's a general purpose. I can also mention some similar software, ArcGIS Server Online, if you know that one, K2DB, or as it just as it's called now, K2 was I was inspired by that project. GeoNode has some similarity to the project, and you can also say GeoServer overlaps GC2 in some areas. So let's get started with the GC2 part of the project. In general terms, GC2 can be described as an easy way to deploy PostGIS, MapServer, QGIS Server, MapCache, GDAL, OGR, and Elasticsearch. And I assume you are somewhat familiar with these software components, so I will not go into details about this. And GC2 offers an easy way to configure the whole software stack. No need to write configuration files or use a terminal. Everything is done through a web browser. Out of the box, all PostGIS tables and views are exposed in a number of APIs like web map service, web feature service, and so on. So this means you can get, let's say, a shapefile from your PC to a PostGIS database and map by map server in a couple of minutes. So this is a schematic representation of GC2. The light blue box at the top is GC2 with all the software components inside. And in the bottom you can see the laptops or computers with the clients. There's GC2 admin, which I will show you in a short while. QGIS can also act as a client. And then to the right, we have Vidi, the browser-based GIS. And you can see the green box, Vidi is actually a standalone system with its own server backend. So this is the GC2 admin application, where you do the configuration of MapServer and MapCache and more. This is the map view where MapServer and MapCache is configured. To the right, you see the map, and to the left, you can see the interface for MapServer and MapCache settings. This is the database view, where you can do some basic database management, like create new tables and views, altering tables, dropping tables, etc. You can also add metadata to your PostGIS layers, like titles, descriptions, and so on. There's a lot of checkboxes and stuff you can do in here. So I'll just start this video. It's a short video showing the basics. Yeah, it's running. So I log into the system with my user profile, like this, and the database is divided into schemas or schemata, and the GC2 admin application works on one schema at the time. This is the map view. I hit the new layer button and choose to upload a vector file, which I pick from my PC. In this case, it's a GML file with windmills. I hit upload. Oh, first I set some, I instruct the importer on which EPS decode and geometry type it has. This is a point file. Then I upload it, and that's it. The data is now imported into PostGIS, a map server layer is defined, and a class also defined with a random color, so you're on your way. This is became red. Yes. Also, it's quite easy to define your own custom map server classes. The system has a I'll just inspect the data in the database view. I'll pick my table. I can see the structure here. And I click on the data tab, and I can actually inspect my data also. And I can edit the data also here. So here I create, just setting up some simple classes using class wizard, creating unique classes with values from one field, and setting some map server settings, like I guess some color, outline color, symbol, stuff like that. And just hit the button, and MapServer is set up, and you can see the map it's chasing in the background. So that was from a GML file to PostGIS and a MapServer in about 1 minute. Yes. So my GML file with windmills is imported into PostGIS, and without any further configuration, all the data can be retrieved or edited using following web service and standard. And I think you know a lot of them. It's OGC standards. Some are OGC standards, some are not, like Google XYZ, UTF grids, and so on. But they are also widely used in client software. So a short short note about integration with QGIS. So, you know QGIS, I think, most of you. But less known is QGIS Server, which is actually derived from MapServer, but uses QGIS rendering engine. So this means that you can expose a desktop, at QGIS desktop project as a web map service. So in GC2 QGIS Server is built into GC2. So you can use either MapServer to render tiles, or you can use QGIS to render tiles. And this fulfills a long-standing desire from GIS users to set up layers only one time for both desktop and web. I have a video which I will skip because of time, but you can download the PowerPoint show and play the video. Go to Vimeo. My Vimeo site is actually pretty cool. So, Vidi, now we have covered GC2 basics and set up some layers and exposed them in services. Now we are going to access them through the browser GS software, Vidi. It's a younger project. It's only a couple of years since we started it, but the last year we have done some extensive development on the project. Some key features now, it is a progressive web app. It works offline. You can filter layers. You can edit layers. It's template-based, so you can change the look and feel. It supports raster tiles, vector tiles, SVG layers, and WebGL layers. And it has a plugin system, so you can extend the functionality. So this is a short video of the basics. I will just play some of it, I think, just a moment. Like, this is how it looks. I can, of course, switch a layer on in the layer tree. I can filter any layer. Doesn't matter if it's map server layer or QGIS server layer. Here I select all areas bigger than 100,000 square meters. I can add as many filters I want, like this. I can do a free text search on every layer out of the box. Just type in something and it will find any feature with that word in. This text search is actually done in PostgreSQL database. You can use wildcard, TS vector, and similarity. I can do drawings, of course, and print maps and all the basic stuff you expect from a WebGIS. The PDF is quite a challenge. You can actually print a PDF and get the scale right. The PDF is generated server-side by something called Puppeteer. It's actually a headless Chromium browser that recreates the whole thing on the server and generate a PDF and squeeze the map together so the scale is right. Here we see a PDF print. So this was a very quick walkthrough of the basics. The newest development we just finished is filtering by foreign key constraint. So if you have two layers, which are two tables or views inside the PostGIS database, which are linked together using a foreign key constraint. So when what you call the parent layer is filtered, the child layers are also automatically filtered. So an example of this is a layer with the bus routes and a layer with bus stops. So when you filter a bus route, like you see here, the blue line is a bus route among many bus routes. Then the layer with bus stops is also filtered at the same time. So this saves a lot of time setting up filters. So the screenshot is just showing a lot of filters put on the bus routes, and when you change it, the bus stops will follow along. This was made for a public transport company. So a word about the different kind of methods for displaying a web map layer. So Vidi has four methods of displaying layers. You have your raster tiles. These are generated by map server, QGIS server, and sent to the browser as ping, PNG, PNG images. This is old school kind of stuff, but it's still the best way of handling a huge amount of data and applying advanced styling. Then you have vector tiles. Those are also generated by MapServer, sent server side and sent to the browser, and actually styled in the browser. This is a newer technology, I guess you all have heard about. Then you can display a layer as a scalable vector graphic. It's a GeoJSON document, generated server side, sent to the browser, and displayed in the browser. The thing about this method is that it can only handle a certain amount of data. If you are going to show a huge layer, you will kill your browser. So we have tried to experiment with WebGL. The methods, it's similar. We send the data to the browser, but we use WebGL to render the layer in the browser. And if you don't know WebGL, it's a GPU supported rendering in the browser, and you can actually, it's crazy fast, and you can render like millions of polygons a point in no time. So this may be the future for WebGS. And Vidi has some has a tentative support for it. It's not all geometry types that is supported at the time. Yeah, it's just a short video of me flickering through the different types. I'll just start it. Like this. So you can let the user, in the video user, choose which kind of method to use to display a layer. This is the windmills from before. First, I choose the raster tiles generated by MapServer, as you remember, the blue dots. I can change to vector methods. Here we get a GeoJSON file from the server, and it is rendered as a scalable vector graphic. I can change to vector tiles, and you can see it looks similar, but you can see it actually pops up in tiles. And in the end, I switch to WebGL, like this. Yeah, it's just a screenshot of what you just saw. Okay. Vidi works offline. I'll just start it and try to explain it. It's running a bit fast. You can see I'm digitizing a new polygon. I can create new features. I'm plotting some attributes. I can actually use a camera on the iPad and store a picture directly in the database. It's a waiting for network, waiting for login. I log in to my iPad, and the polygon, in a moment, is stored in the PostGIS database. So here I go into fly mode on my iPad, so no connection at all. And you can see I can reload the app, and I can reload it again. And I can actually still edit my feature. Like this, hit submit. This orange label saying waiting for network, there's no network now. Now I'm going out of fly mode, and in a moment it will detect a connection and it will send it to the PostGIS database. So it's well suited for field registration without good coverage. So time is running. Yeah, how does this work? It's only in modern browsers. No Internet Explorer, and Apple just added support for service workers last year, so that was really good news. So you can use it on all major platforms. So future development, there's a lot of things to do, but full implementation of WebGL layers is on the wish list. And also methods for styling of vector tiles, QGIS, everything vector, we need some styling system. Right now you have to write an extension to style a layer, so it's a bit difficult. Yeah, that's it.
Thank you very much for your nice presentation, and I hope you have time to accept questions, yeah, if they are. Yes.
Hello. Just a question on how users are meant to use your front-end Vidi. Do you have like any permission systems where you can give users permissions to certain layers? And you mentioned you have like similarities to GeoNode. Is it possible to set up like a combination of layers already so that they can be represented to the user as a map? And do you have permission as well for users to contribute back data?
Yeah, but I skipped that. Yeah, there's a privilege system where you can, you know, grant write-read rights to users, and you have, we call it sub-users. It's actually a mirror of the user system in PostgreSQL database, so it will also be forwarded to the PostGIS database. Yeah.
Hi. I was wondering how easy or difficult it is to change the interface for the user in a certain map if you want to have your own custom tool or something. Can that be integrated?
Yes, very easy. It's using something called a mustache template. It's using something called a mustache template. It's HTML with some placeholders, and you can just add your own. You can store your templates remotely, and Vidi will fetch them from a site like GitHub or somewhere. So it's quite easy to do. And you don't have to have any programming experience, only HTML.
Is there a way to document the layers as metadata? Does it have a metadata client like by CSW?
It has a system where you can define your own properties. So if you're going to follow a standard or have your own, you can do that. So it's on the installation. You can set up like which properties you want to be able to give a layer. So inside the GC2 admin page, you can actually get that like a formula and fill it out for each layer. Yes, and all these metadata can be retrieved in using an API. Yeah.
Hi, I was just wondering if you have any plans to incorporate WPS or anything like that in the future.
I've been looking at Sue project to actually add that to the stack and make some interface, but it's not on the top of the list yet. If somebody wants it, I may gonna make it, but. Yeah.
Yeah. Any more questions? Everybody happy? Okay. So thank you very much for your talk. And after a short break, we move to the next one. Thank you.